Counselor, mighty God, who Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. I'm so glad you are here with us to worship. It is a beautiful day. It is an important day. Without Christ's resurrection, there would be no reason to have faith in him. And so I welcome you, and I pray that you enjoy this time. I want to remind you, this is not a video to watch. Worship is more than a show. It is an act. It is a verb. And so I invite you, as you see this video, to worship together with those who are leading. Let's begin right now. Today's scripture comes from Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 10. After the Sabbath, at dawn, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." This is the word of God for the people of God. Amen.
1, 2, 3, Jesus is alive. 1, 2, 3, Jesus is alive. He died for you and me, but on day 3, Jesus rose again. Jesus is alive.
1, 2, 3, Jesus is alive. 1, 2, 3, Jesus is alive. He died for you and me, but on day 3, Jesus rose again. Jesus is alive.
God loved the world.
God loved the world.
So he gave his son.
So he gave his son.
Jesus is our friend.
Jesus is our friend.
He loves everyone.
He loves everyone.
Jesus is alive. 1, 2, 3. Jesus is alive. He died for you and me, but on day 3, Jesus rose again. Jesus is alive.
1, 2, 3. Jesus is alive. 1, 2, 3. Jesus is alive. He died for you and me, but on day 3, Jesus rose again. Jesus is alive. He died for you and me, but on day 3, Jesus rose again. Jesus is alive.
Years ago, probably around 1980, my brothers and I went with my grandparents to church. We all lined up in the pew, dressed in our new Easter clothes. My little brother from the very beginning of the day was tugging at his collar and pulling on his shirt. Now, most of us just figured it was because no 5 or 6 year old little boy wants to wear a button down collared shirt. But when we got to church and we were sitting in the pew, he got more uncomfortable. And so as he was adjusting his collar, he found something under his collar, and it was a piece of cardboard. You know that cardboard that they put under the collars in the store to make sure they stand up? Well, he felt it, and he started pulling it and pulling it and pulling it, and his eyes got bigger and bigger and bigger, and it was so funny. My older brother started to giggle. My little brother started to giggle. I started to giggle. Even my grandmother and grandfather started to giggle. And what ensued then was the worst case of church giggles we've ever had. You know the church giggles, the ones where you're supposed to be quiet, but something is hilarious. And so you just sit there and shake and try not to guffaw at the funny, funny thing that's happening. Well, we all got the case of the church giggles. And so then my mother, who was up in the choir with my dad, who was playing the organ, she was in the side balcony, during the sermon where we were having the church giggles, and she did what she does best. She looked at us and shot lasers out of her eyes, so much so that we felt the heat. It was as if she was saying, you better settle down and you better listen to the pastor. And those lasers, you know, sort of made us sober up and we became calm again. I think of that story every Easter. My brothers and I, when we get together, we talk about that story. We tell that story and we finally can laugh out loud, and we certainly do. But this year, as the story came to mind, I found myself looking at the gospel accounts of Easter in a new way. You see, my brother went to church that morning feeling like something wasn't quite right. Something was a little off. He was uncomfortable, yet he did not know the cause of his discomfort. Can you identify with that? I imagine each of us comes to worship today feeling like something is not quite right. Things are a little off. Maybe you're lonely today. Or maybe you're experiencing anxiety in your life over finances or job or relationships. Maybe you're working through an addiction, working through finding something to fill your life, searching for something to fill the emptiness in your life. And most of us, I suspect, are feeling anxiety and sorrow and pain overwhelmingly over the pandemic that we are dealing with right now. Wouldn't it be a joy if we could be together, face to face, side by side, singing together, hugging each other? Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could do that? But we can't. We are at home today. And so many of us sit here today and we find ourselves thinking something just isn't quite right. But Easter came anyway. Easter comes whether we are in a pew at the church or on the couch. Easter comes whether we are dressed in our new clothes or in our PJs. Easter comes regardless of how we feel this morning. Easter comes because Easter came. The tomb was empty. The spices the women brought were useless because there was no body to prepare. The angels in their dazzling white robes told them that Jesus had indeed risen from the dead, just as he said he was going to do. Well, you might be thinking, well, isn't that lovely, Pastor Anna? But it sounds like you are telling the story without compassion for the worries and the weight of the pain I'm feeling right now. But I want you to know that there is compassion in the story I am sharing today. There is compassion in the celebration of Easter. I want you to hear the story and you'll see what I mean. We were created, humanity was created in the image of God. I think of it as a reflection in the mirror, the image of God. Yet, when we sinned, that image became like a cracked mirror. And for thousands of years, we have been trying to repair that crack. During the Old Testament times, before Jesus' death and resurrection, there were specific commands to follow to make ourselves right with God. There were dietary restrictions. There were sacrifices to be made. But we even failed to do that right because we are sinners and the mirror was cracked. And so, God, out of compassion, who wanted a relationship with us, came down from heaven, left his perfect self and place and home to come and be a human like us, to be born so poor that he had to lay on hay after his childbirth as an infant. He was raised by regular people. He experienced being scolded by mom and dad, having headaches. He experienced being hungry and being tired, being angry, being worried. Jesus experienced all of these things because it was time for the final sacrifice, the final lamb to be sacrificed, and he was the perfect lamb. And so he died for us. And he didn't stay dead. He left the tomb. He rose from the dead and he conquered sin forever. No more sacrifices to be made. This is the compassion God showed. And he didn't only show it for me or for anybody around us and all of us around us, which is true, but I want you to think of this and I want you to know this. No matter how you feel today, God did this for you. For you. Whether you're lonely or anxious or scared or overwhelmed, something doesn't feel quite right, know this. Even though we're not quite right, God is perfectly right. And he came to fix things for us. Now, I'm not saying that it's perfect. It's easy to celebrate Easter. I'm not saying that life doesn't come with pain and sorrow. But what I am saying is that when life is over, we will all be healed and whole. No pain, no sorrow, no sadness, but nothing but whole, healed beauty with God forever. And so I want to continue my story about my brother because this part is my favorite. After the sermon finished, we got to stand up and we sang, "Christ the Lord is risen today." And we were singing and it was great. My brothers and I knew this song, even though we could not read it very quickly. And my little brother had that piece of cardboard and he was whirling it around and doing a little boogie. Again, we got a little bit of church giggles, but it was hidden by the music. And so I want us to take a lesson from my little brother. I want us to take a little boogie, take a little dance. Yes, there was discomfort. There is discomfort. But for a moment, for today, let's just boogie a little. Let's just get down. Let's crack a little smile. Let's even have a church giggle. It's okay to do so. In fact, we can all stand a church giggle right now, can't we? So let's do it. Because don't we have every reason to do so? And all of God's children said, "Alleluia, amen."
From the grave he arose, with the mighty die upon his cross.
What have we heard?
We have heard the good news.
What have we seen?
We have seen the good news.
What have we shouted?
We have shouted the good news.
What have we sung?
We have sung the good news.
Now, what do we do?
Let's live the good news.
Christ is risen. He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Amen.
Where Jesus